Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executeth righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. Acts chapter 10, verse 34. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Acts 10 and 34. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. But in every nation he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. The word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. That word, I say, ye know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Father, in the name of Jesus, I appreciate, Lord, this scripture. And I pray that you would take control, Lord, of me right now and use me in a way that would edify the church, that would lift up the bodies, the individuals, the members of the church. Lord, the members making up the body of Christ. God, in the name of Jesus, let it be so. God, do something for those that's come out here, Lord, to be filled and fed thy word. Fill them and feed them, God, thy word tonight, in Jesus' name. God, if there be one here that's a sinner, let this be the night that they might be converted. If there's one here that's backslid, let this be the night that they would come back to God. Lord, if there's one here, Lord, that's bound and needs deliverance, so if there's one that's sick, let them be delivered or healed or both. We ask it in Jesus' name, by his stripes. Lord, we are healed. We were healed. By the blood of Jesus Christ, our healing, Lord, has been guaranteed to us and for us. We love you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank God. We're going to talk to you about forgiveness, healing, and power. Praise God. Now, the Lord spoke through David and said that he would forgive. David rather relayed the message that God told him, and he spoke to the people that was in his day and said that God forgiveth thee of all thine iniquities and healeth thee of all thine diseases. How many knows he did? Hallelujah. And he went on and spoke how that God would redeem us or redeem man and give man victory over destruction. Amen to God. In other words, which was to say that God would give the power unto the individual. Amen. That they wouldn't have to suffer destruction. Praise God. But that have the victory over destruction. That have victory over sin, if you'll have it. Thank you, Jesus. And God told me, he said, salvation brings three things. He said it brings forgiveness, it brings healing, and it brings my power. Amen. I said amen. I spoke about here the other night on a message and preached about the Spirit of God and the power of God. And said how that you couldn't have the power of God without having the Spirit of God first. If they received the power after that the Spirit, which is the Holy Ghost, came upon them, then and only then do they have any power with God. So you've got to get His Spirit in you before that you can have any power, amen, that can be manifested through you to others. Then you've got to have, first of all, you must have His Spirit in you before that power is going to come out of you. Because without His Spirit, you ain't got nothing. I tell you right now what them people has got that don't have the Holy Ghost that calls themselves preachers. They ain't got nothing but the Word. They ain't got no Spirit. And the Bible still says the letter kill it. But the Spirit makes alive. Hallelujah. How many knows that's right? And somewhere, someday, somehow, some kind of way, they're going to have to get more than what they got if they ever expect to make it into God's kingdom. Because the Bible still says, without the Spirit of Christ, you're none of His, and we cannot change God's Word. Man has not got the authority. Man does not have the right to change the Word of God. And if God said it, God meant what He said, and God's going to bring it to pass. We might as well get ready, as I said so many times, to line up to the Word of God, because my way and your way is not going to get us there. It's going to take the way of God and the will of God to get me and you, amen, where God's at. But God wants to do something for us. God loves me and you tonight. God loves everyone that's here tonight in this camp meeting revival. How many knows that you're not here by accident, but there's something other that calls you to be here in this service tonight? And that something other that I believe that calls you to be here tonight is what we call the Spirit of God. It's what we call the Holy Ghost. Amen. That's caused you. Something has moved upon you and caused you to get yourself ready and come down here. Amen. Or over here or up here, whichever case it might be from where you live, to be in this service tonight. Hallelujah. Because way down deep inside of you, there's a hunger that you might not even realize, but your soul knows. How many knows that deep down inside of man and woman, the soul of man yearns to be like its maker? Can you say praise God? I said it yearns to be like God. Oh yes, it does. Thank you, Jesus. David was one of the preachingest kings that I ever knew in my life or ever heard of was David. He was the preachingest king that ever come upon the scene. Hallelujah. And Isaiah was one of the, he was the most preachingest prophet that I've ever known anything about prophesying. He done more preaching just about than he did prophesying. He had the gospel. How many knows he preached the gospel in his day to those people? I preached a message here about Isaiah's gospel. How many knows I did? Praise God. So Isaiah was a prophet, but he preached the word of God. Oh, yes, he did. I said, yes, he did. David was a king, but he declared the word of the Lord. How many knows he did? And David's main concern was to see souls saved. David's main concern was to see people's iniquity forgiven. David's main concern was to see, amen, the hearts and the lives of individuals to be clean and cleansed by the Spirit and the power of God, because he knew, amen, he was going to take the power of God, amen, to get rid of man's iniquity. Seven of us, that's right. Praise God. God spoke to David in Psalms 103, and he spoke to those people, and he says, the Lord God forgiveth thee of all thine iniquities. He healeth thee of all thine diseases. How many knows he said that? Praise the name of the Lord. I said, praise God. And so, the first thing that happens to me and you after that we repent, first of all, it has to begin within you. You'll never have anything from God until first you make the first move. How many knows the Spirit of God will deal with your heart? It'll strive in your heart. God will cause you to come under conviction. How many knows? But that is the work and that is the job of the Spirit of God, to move upon the hearts and the lives of people. Amen. But when it comes to the accepting part, it is up to that individual to either receive God's Word or to reject God's Word. And to say, glory. Praise God. The Holy Ghost is doing His work. The Holy Ghost is working in this day. How many believes it is? It's not because the Holy Ghost or the Spirit of God has not spoke to people, but it's because that people has not heard what the Spirit had to say unto them. The Spirit of God is a moving across the land, and it's a speaking to people in this hour we're living in. How many believes it is? Oh, yes, it is. And Jesus, by His Spirit, it's just like He was standing there in person. And He's saying, come unto me, all you that labor or heavy laden, I will give you rest. Hallelujah. He wants to give you rest for your troubled soul. And it believes he does. The Spirit of God moves across the congregation, across this nation and other nations. The Spirit of God is moving, and it's a tugging at the hearts of people. It's a knocking at man and woman's heart's door. I mean, those in Jesus is wanting to come in. But it's going to be up to me and you whether we let him in or not. I mean, ladies, that's right. Somebody said the lock's on the inside, and I believe it is too. I believe the door of mind your heart has only one handle or one doorknob, and it's on the inside. And I believe only mind your saying, mind your being, amen, submissive to his will and saying, yes, Lord. I believe that yes is the combination, amen, that opens it, turns the doorknob, or turns the handle on the door, amen, it calls the door to swing open, and your spirit reaches out and says, even so, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. I believe the word yes, Lord, is what gets your door open, and you say, glory, praise the name of Jesus. That's your combination. That's my new combination. How many's ever seen a combination lock? Anybody comes along, can't open it. You know who can open a combination lock? Who knows who can open a combination lock? Only to the one that has the combination. Amen. You can work on it all day long. Oh, they got a thief, it might get it open sooner or later. We ain't talking about thieves. We talk about somebody that's going to turn away from their thievery. We're talking about somebody that's going to come clean with God. We're not talking about somebody that's going to try to rob God or be a thief against God. But we're talking about somebody, amen, that's getting ready to turn their heart and their life over the Lord Jesus Christ. And when they say yes to the Spirit of God, within that door hell turns and that heart's door swings open. Amen. And then the Spirit of God can come in and the Word of God can come in. And the blood of Jesus can be applied to the inside of your heart. Tell you one thing, I ain't never felt like there's no blood on the outside of my heart. I believe he puts the blood on the inside. And the door went back closed. I got Christ in my heart and I pulled the door back too. Amen. Praise God. I want you to know there's something inside of my heart. How many of you knows that inside of your heart, not on top of your heart, not around your heart, not laying upon your heart, but in your heart. He said you got to write this word in your heart, on your heart and in your heart. It's got to be in the inward part of man. How many of you got to get this word on the inward part of man? And he say, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. And I tell you what I done one day. I said, yes, Lord. And my door came open. And Jesus Christ walked right in. And I said, praise God. And I believe he pulled the door behind him closed. I believe, Baba Hashiach. I believe that when Jesus walked in, he reached back there and pulled my heart's door to me. Amen. Now he's sealed up in my heart. I ain't going to let him out. I'm not going to let him out. I'm going to keep Jesus in my heart. The Apostle Paul says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. He said, you got to get Christ in your heart. Amen. And let him close the door behind himself. Amen. He's sealed up in my heart. And I'm going to keep him in there. How many of you going to keep your Jesus in your heart? Glory to God. Glory to Jesus. Praise God. And so here comes forgiveness. And he forgives us of our sin. If you haven't blasphemed the Holy Ghost, you can be forgiven. If you've blasphemed the Holy Ghost, well, you can pray until you turn as many colors and have as many stripes on you as a zebra. Amen. But how many knows you'll still not make it? If we haven't blasphemed his Holy Ghost or his Holy Spirit, amen, we can pray and you can commit any kind of sin under the sun that can be committed. And all manner of sin, the Bible said, shall be or will be forgiven against man, save or accept the blaspheme against the Holy Ghost. How many believe this is the truth? Hallelujah. That's the glory to God. How many has ever heard about Al Capone? How many knows what Brother Hayes come in here and talked about? He knew about this man, amen, that witnessed to Al Capone and said they had a testimony that before Al Capone died, that he gave his heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. How many knows that Al Capone had killed many people and he had given order? Amen. He had sent out contracts, what they call contracts, to get people killed. And had killed many people.
I mean, knows that's right. But being a murderer and an outlaw and a thief and an embezzler and everything else, I mean, knows that the Lord Jesus Christ heard his cry. And when he said, "Yes, Lord," according to what the man said, Al Capone opened his heart's door and Jesus walked in. I might say, "Thank you, Lord." I mean, believes if God can save Al Capone, God can save me and you. And he said, "Glory." Hallelujah. I said, "Glory to Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord." And God forgave him of all his lying, of all his cheating, of his embezzlement, of his everything that had against him. Amen. The government, everybody else. Of all of his thievery, his murdering, his bootlegging. Amen. When God forgives, he forgets. Amen. So salvation brings forgiveness. How many believes it does? Hallelujah. Somebody say glory. Don't you appreciate tonight? I love him tonight. Sinners needs this message. Backsliders needs this message. You know what forgiveness does? It frees us from the guilt of sin. I preached that message last night about Day of Freedom, didn't I? Amen. Has there ever been a masterpiece preached in this church? Even if I preach it, I'll still say that was a masterpiece. Hallelujah. Glory to God. If a sermon or a message could be a masterpiece, I believe that that was a masterpiece last night about Day of Freedom. Amen. Because it come from God. Praise God. So forgiveness, we want to talk about our freedom. Then the forgiveness of the Lord Jesus Christ that's extended to me and you by and through his mercy clears and cleans and frees me and you of all the guilt of sin. I'll tell you one thing for sure. I don't know how you feel about it, but not one sin that I committed before I come to the Lord Jesus Christ worries me anymore. It does not bother me. I'm not tormented by it whatsoever. I might can still, he said, I don't have some be ashamed for it, but I don't feel guilty. I don't be ashamed enough to be guilty because it's just like I ain't never done it. How many knows when the Lord forgiveness comes to your life, he takes the guilt and sin out of your life, and you don't have to walk around here all bowed down and heavy laden under the yoke of sin, but you can have your victory, you can have your joy, and you just like you've been born all over. How many knows this is true? It's just like a life that was there that's not there no more. I don't feel guilty about not one thing that I've done. I felt guilty until I repented of it. Until the Lord Jesus Christ brought forth his forgiveness through his salvation, I felt guilty. I could go out and go on the town or whatever and stay gone for a day or two and do things. Amen. Drink, carouse around, do things and waste my money. Get out and blow my tires out on my automobile by wrecking my car and tearing the sides off my car. All kind of thing. Ended up in jail. And I'd feel ashamed of it. When it was all over and when I sobered up, I had a guilty feeling. How many knows what a guilty feeling is? I feel like a sheep killing dog. If there's any such thing as a sheep killing dog, I felt like a sheep killing dog. Amen. When I come into the house, I'd want to hold my head up and say, "Hello, honey." But I'd come in there with my head hanging almost down between my knees. I'd be so embarrassed. I'd be so ashamed. I'd have such a guilt in my life because of what I've done that I couldn't even look my own self in the face, alone somebody else. Amen. But I want you to know, November 8th of 1964, when I said, "Yes, Lord," and my heart's door swung open to receive Christ on the inside of me, and Jesus walked on the inside of my heart and pulled the door to behind him. Amen. But God, I don't feel no guilt no more, because the forgiveness that comes from God, it will wipe away every bit of your guilt, and you can hold your head up and you can be proud. I mean, please, you can. And you don't have to be tormented about something God's forgiven you of. And he said, "Thank God for that." Praise God. Don't you let the devil bring your past up, something God's done for God. The devil ain't never going to forget nothing you've done. But God will forget about it. God will throw it in the seal for forgetfulness. If there's any such a sea, or God will throw it behind his back so far it'll never be brought back. even to God's remembrance. God won't cause it to be remembered against you no more, not any longer. How many knows that's right? If you were to go out here and backslide tomorrow, you'll never feel guilty for that sin back here that you repented of. The only guilt that you're going to have is going to be from the sin that you start committing after you backslid. Are you listening to me? I said, when God forgives you, God forgets about it, and God ain't going to bring it up to you, and you can go on and think it, and you can praise the Lord. I believe you can. Thank you, Jesus. God will bring that sin that you committed that caused you to backslide. God will bring that to you. You'll walk under the guilt of that sin. But you'll never walk under the guilt of any sin that God's ever forgive you of. And you say, praise God. That's gone. If I should backslide and end up in hell, it won't be because them sins back here. I can tell you for sure them sins is gone. It'd be because what I do from the day I backslide, that's what I'm going to stand before God. I'll never have to stand before God and give an account of something other than an account that's already been settled. How many knows that mine, your old account was settled when the blood of Jesus Christ was applied in mine, your heart and life? It was mine, your old account was settled by His blood. How many knows that mine, your sin debt was paid, and it's not going to be brought up in hell against it again? And you say, thank God for that. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. I said, praise God. Forgiveness. I'm talking about it frees us from the guilt of sin. In this scripture, we talk about this scripture so much. Not only myself, but others, I hear them talking about and quoting Romans 8:1, but it's such a great truth in this verse. There is therefore now, talking about right now, no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. There's no condemnation. There's no guilt. There is therefore when no guilt? Now. There is therefore now no condemnation or guilt. Hallelujah. I said, praise God. Hey, man, I don't have to be ashamed to face my neighbor. I don't have to be ashamed to walk downtown and have somebody to point the finger and say, I seen you back 20 years ago, back when you was a drunkard. It don't matter what I was 20 years ago. I want you to know, God forgive me of being a drunkard. And I'm not no drunkard today. I've been born again. I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. I've been forgiven of my sin. I've had my iniquities forgiven and my sins and transgressions cleansed, and I no longer have to walk under that guilt or that shame of sin. And they say, praise God. Hallelujah. I said, glory, Baba Hashiah. Glory to Jesus. Amen. That's right. Now, I've done some terrible things, but I feel clean now. To me, it's just like they never happened. Because to God, it's just like they never happened. Hey man, God's forgot about him. I have too. Well, the devil will try to bring up something every once in a while. If I ever tell anything about the past at all, it's because that I feel that some way, somehow, that maybe it's one of my experiences or experiments might be able, amen, to help somebody else. And that's the only way that you can ever. Paul says, forget those things that are behind. He said, let us press on. Let us press towards the mark for the prize of the higher call of God, which is in Christ Jesus. It's time to forget about the things that are behind and look outside into the future. How many believe this is true? Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. This is something other. Maybe this little extra here, but I want you to get this right here. I'll tell you something. Amen. When God forgives you, He cleans you up, and He expects you to do something other. God ain't never saved nobody or forgive somebody their sins. We use the term saved, but it's a conversion. How many of us are a conversion? Amen. None has ever been truly converted to the Lord and just want to go somewhere and sit down, not never do anything at all. You can't do that. You can't be converted and just go and sit down. I ain't telling you don't go and sit in the congregation. I ain't talking about that. How many knows that God's talking about He wants you to witness to people out yonder? God wants you to get out in the streets and the highways and the lanes and the hedges and all these places and on the telephone and on your job and amen in the shopping centers or wherever you might go. The Lord wants you to talk to people about the Lord Jesus Christ. How many believes He does? I witnessed to a Catholic family today. I went to see a Catholic people today right here in the Picayune area. Amen. And I introduced myself to him. I told him I want to meet him and everything. And I felt led to go over there and I talked to him for a while, invited him to church. Amen. You know, first thing he said, and I told him we had a camp meeting going on. We'd like for him to come be in the service. You know, first thing he said, well, I'm a Catholic. I said, I don't remember there was me. And I shocked him. He didn't have no idea what to say. And I said, I don't make no difference. Amen. I ain't worried about, amen, that right now. God will take care of that later. How many will? We've got to get him exposed to the Word of God. Let the Spirit of God do the rest. He said, well, I'll have to ask my father about it. I said, well, amen. But I went on to talk to him about some other things. Thank you, Jesus. When I left, he was smiling. So was his wife. Thank you, Jesus. I left something behind. Thank you, Lord. Went over with my blue jeans on. I had on my Levi's or blue jeans. And I had on a blue jean shirt and a pair of cowboy boots. And I was just as down to earth as he was. You see what I'm talking about? There's a time and place for all things. How many is it is? I could have put on this suit and went over in this suit or put on another suit. Amen. Went over in that suit. Went over clearing my throat and acting like some dignitary. How many as I could. And when I drove up in my little automobile and I got out and I was just as country as he was. And I said, glory to God. Paul became all things to all men that he by the word and the wisdom and the ways of God might be able to win some to Christ. How many knows he did? Paul walked among them. He became as they were. Yet he did not take up their ways. He did not do like they've done. But he became equal to them. How does he do that? He was able to witness to people of any class because he could speak their language. Well, somebody say praise God. So, but anyway, when we are saved, we're saved to do something. We're not saved to go somewhere and sit down and say, I'm saved, hallelujah, I'm saved. And forget it. But you go to work when you get saved, how does he do? First thing I want to do is tell somebody else about this Jesus. You get this Christ in you just right. You can't wait to tell somebody else about him. How many believes it's the truth? Glory to God. God saves me in you and puts me in you to work. Yes, he does. So he told me, he said, tell the people they're saved to serve. The Christian life is like riding a bicycle. Do you know that? We either go on or get off. You ever try to ride a bicycle? You can't sit still on a bicycle. How knows you can? Hallelujah. I said the Christian life is like riding a bicycle. Either you go on or you get off of it, or it'll fall on top of you. I said the bicycle will fall on top of you. How many is getting ready to go on? I said I'm getting ready to go on. We ain't got no time to stop. We ain't got no time to sit still. And we got to go on. And you say praise God. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. God saved us to serve. Oh yes he did. Praise God, but we're still on forgiveness. That's something that comes with forgiveness. It calls you to want to go out and forgive somebody else. First thing you'll want to do is look up somebody's done something wrong to you where you can go and forgive them. Amen. Lord God, I tell you, I never didn't know that my enemies were so pretty until I got Christ in me. I thought they don't look so bad after all. Amen to God. God will cause you to love your enemies. How many believe he will? He even taught us to love our enemies. Yes, he did. So what does forgiveness do for me and you? Forgiveness gives us a new hope. Is that right? It gives us a new life. It gives us a second chance. Salvation, when it comes to your house, or when Christ comes and knocks on your door, that's your second chance. You done blowed your first chance because you hadn't accepted him before then. Amen? You've been out here living in a life of sin and your first chance is gone. You messed it up. But this is your second chance. Hallelujah. I said, praise God. It might be the first time that the Spirit of God's ever spoke to your heart, but it's going to be your second chance to learn what life is really all about. You ain't never really lived until you've known the Lord. If you live for 50 years and you haven't received Christ, you ain't lived at all until you've known Jesus. How many believe that's right? Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. God's given me the message for the camp meeting. How many believe he's given me the message for the camp meeting? And I'm going to deliver these messages and I'm going to leave here just as happy as I can leave you. Praise the name of the Lord. And whosoever hears and receives will be blessed. And so forgiveness gives us a new hope. It gives us a new life. It gives us a change, a second chance if you have it to do what's right. Amen. Acts 13 and 38. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. Talking about Jesus. How many believes he was talking about Jesus? Praise God. I want to say one other thing about forgiveness, and I'll give you a verse of scripture. That was Acts 13 and 38. And Galatians chapter 1 verse 14. In whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. The blood of Jesus Christ cleans us of all guilt. How many believes it does? Amen. I don't have to repent over what I've already repented over. If you've repented over it, the Lord's forgive you, that's the end of it. How many still knows what I'm saying about that? I said, that's the end of it. That brings the period to the end of the sentence. Amen. When the Lord has forgiven you. Then there's healing. We're talking about forgiveness, healing. Amen. And power. And it was all taken from Psalms chapter 103, verses 1 through 6. And those few verses in Acts chapter 10. Verses 34 through 38. But then there's healing. He said he healeth all their diseases, but there's more to be healed than just a natural disease. How many believes it is? There's more that needs healing. First of all, he forgives you. Then the power of God, the work of God begins to go to work in your life. The work of God, the work of Christ begins to work in your life. The forgiveness brings forth the healing for our sin. Our sin-sick soul, first of all, how many knows your soul has been sick? Sure it has. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses and heals your sin-sick soul. I had a sick soul. I don't know how yours was, but my soul was sick. I felt like I really was. How many knows when you can get where you can see yourself like that, you feel like that God's looking at you, you're pretty sick. How knows you got a pretty sick soul when you can see yourself and I can see myself? I don't know exactly how God see me, but I sure see myself in a bad shape. I said, the day that I come under conviction, I see myself. It was like I was looking through someone else's eyes. And I see myself like I'd never seen myself before. Hallelujah. I said, praise God. How many knows the same thing happened to the prodigal son? How many knows he'd never seen himself before until he got down there away from his father and away from his brother and his kindred and his people? Amen. When he got out of the household, amen, of his father, how many knows the Bible said, and he came to himself. In other words, he seen himself like he really was. And on that day, he said, I'll arise and I'll go to my father. And that's what I've done when I said, yes, Lord, I'll accept you into my heart and I'll accept you into my life. Amen. I was wanting to get my sin sick soul healed. I was tired of being sick. I was tired of being tormented from the inside. The worst pain you'll ever have is the pain that comes from the tormenting of sin. Hallelujah. To have a sin sick soul and not be able to get no relief. You can take as many aspirins and Standbacks and Pepto-Bismol as you want, anything else, but it won't heal that feeling. How does it won't? Yeah. Praise God. You go out here and you have a headache or stomach ache and you take some kind of old natural pill or medicine or something other natural, while it'll be gone. Won't it? Yeah. I said, won't it? Praise God. But when you're sick in your soul, there's only one thing that'll bring forth healing. And it's the blood of Jesus Christ. By his stripes we were healed, said Isaiah. It's by the stripes, it's by the shed blood of Jesus Christ that mine your soul is healed. And nothing else is healing balm for mine your soul except the shed blood of Christ. Praise God. So it's a healing for our sin sick soul. It's healing from the stains, the scars, and bruises of Satan. And you better believe he'll put a lot of ammonia too. The devil knows. The devil's got a good name when he said booger man. Well, he'll sure booger you up. How many knows that there couldn't be a better name given to the devil except booger man? He's the biggest booger man there ever is, and he gets to booger you up. You'll look worse than a booger man. I said you'll look worse and feel worse than a booger man. How many believes you will? He'll cause you to be bruised and scarred from the top of your head to the sole of your feet. How many knows that's right? But I want you to know the blood of Jesus Christ will come in there. It'll cleanse and cure every wound, every stain of sin, and every scar. I want you to know the blood of Jesus will heal your sin-sick soul and your bruised and your scarred inner man. It'll clean it up and heal it. How many believes it will? So you see, salvation brings forth not only forgiveness, but also healing. I said healing. Amen. Healing for our battered, worn, torn members of sin's blow. You see what I'm talking about? Giving you a new mind, that's what I'm talking about. Amen. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. How many knows he'll take out that old satanic mind, amen, that you had, that old lustful demon, amen, that old pride of life, and the cares of the world. How many knows that old envy, jealousy, that old backbiting, hatred spirit on the inside of you, it'll clean your soul up, it'll clean your mind up. How many knows that this word will clean your mind and heal your mind and make your mind whole? And you say, glory. Oh, yes, it will. Hallelujah. The Apostle Paul knew that man's going to have something in his mind as well as his heart. That's why he said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. You got to have his mind. Hey, amen. My mind's clean tonight. How many of you's got a clean mind? Hey, amen. I've been healed. My mind has been healed. Oh, yes, it has. I don't think evil thoughts no more. I got a clean mind. My brain won't comprehend any kind of evil. Because the Holy Ghost gives me the power to overcome it. The Holy Ghost gives me the power to resist. Amen. Let evil thoughts, amen, abide in my heart and my life. Or take over my mind. And say, thank God. Throw up your hands and say, praise God. Amen. Yes, healing for our battered, worn, torn members of sin's blow. You know what I'm talking about? I'm talking about walking under torment. It'll drive that tormenting demon away from your thinking capacity. How many believes he will? You won't have to walk around under the guilt of sin no longer. Hallelujah. You won't be haunted by the memories of the past. Amen. A Satan's vile blow against your memory, against your mind, to cause you to walk under torment or the spirit of fear. He'll cause it to be removed out from under you. Can you say praise God? He'll give you a new spirit. He'll give you a new heart. He'll give you a new mind. Amen. You'll be able to think clean thoughts when you ask Christ to come in. Won't you do it? So he heals your mind. How many believes he heals your mind? Not only does he heal your soul, heal your heart, but he heals your mind. Amen. Healing from a soul, a far soul that's been left bleeding and broken from sin's fury and rage, God said. Hallelujah. We got a bleeding and a broken soul that's been left over from sin's fury and sin's rage and sin's toll. How many knows that sin takes a toll when it comes sweeping through the land? How many knows it takes its toll and it takes its toll? Amen to God. But God will clean you up from all that. God will wipe away all that things, all that old bad memory. God will take it out of your mind, and God will cause you to have a new heart, and he'll put a new thinking capacity operating on your side of that old natural mind. I want you to know you won't think like a natural man no more, but you'll begin to see things like Jesus sees things. You'll cause your mind to become spiritual, and you say, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Sometimes I can't even add up what 15 or 10 and 12 is. Sometimes I get so caught up in the spirit. Sometimes I can't hardly talk to people. I ain't, amen, trying to exaggerate, but you know what I'm talking about. Amen. You can get so heavily minded sometimes you can't hardly carry on an earthly conversation. Especially after you come out of a service like this. I can't hardly talk to folks out of a service like this. It's the truth anyhow. Can you say, you know what I'm talking about, don't you? How many knows I'm telling you the truth? When you get caught up, even sitting out there in the congregation, even you as saints of God, even you as preachers and missionaries sitting in the congregation under this word tonight, after a word like this falls on you, you don't want to go out trying to carry on some kind of really natural conversation, because your mind's not fixed on the natural things, but you've been caught up in the spirit, and your mind's been exalted, your spirit's caught up, your heart's a leaping for joy, and you don't want no natural conversation, amen, with somebody that ain't caring about God no how. And he said, glory, praise God. Now stay away from people, amen, that don't know God. Now come out of a service like this. If they called for my help, I'd go. But I'm not going to invite trouble. I used to tell people, I said, don't you gather a bunch of people, I said, don't y'all gather in a house and drink coffee at midnight? Hey, man, and get an old worldly conversation going on. I said, don't do that. Hey, man. I said, because when you come out under service like this, I said, you'd be better off to go to your own homes. Amen. But people want to congregate. People want to get together. People like this here fleshly fellowship. Well, it's all right in its place, but we need some spiritual fellowship. If you're going to leave a service like this, and you're going to carry on a conversation with somebody, you need to be talking about Jesus. You need to be talking about the Lord. You don't need to be talking about the weather. You don't need to be talking about your hardships. Amen. Or your discouragements. But you need to be talking about the victory of Jesus and the power of God in your life. And it's a glory. Hallelujah. Rabbah Hashem. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. As they come against my word, just deliberately and straight out, bless God, you ain't going to tell me what to do. So they're gone. Amen. And I'm talking about they're gone when I say gone too. But if they had heard, if they took fast hold of instruction and kept it and let it not go, it would have meant their life. Amen. But they was caught up in flesh. They wouldn't be concerned about God's word. They weren't concerned about living for God. Amen. And it's like them people was that Jesus looked down upon Jerusalem. Amen. He said, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. He said, how oft I would have gathered you together as a hen would have been under her wings. They said, you would not. And he said, but behold, your house is left unto you desolate because you are not in my words. I said prophets unto you. I said holy men of God unto you. But you rejected their words and you were not in my reproof. Amen. He said, behold, your house is left unto you desolate. And he said, help me, Jesus. Hallelujah. I said, glory by high. Sweep your hands up and praise him. Glory by high. Thank you, Jesus. But this word, brother, going to stand. This word's moving on. Oh, yes, it is. I said, yes, it is. And things that people does to me, it used to hurt me, don't hurt me no more. It don't bother me no more. I got the victory over it. I can shrug it off and let it go. Consider the source it come from and mark it as ignorant and let it go. Praise God. And say, thank you, Lord. Amen. You can get something in your heart and your soul to give you victory. Amen. Over the torments of flesh. I don't believe you can. Praise the name of the Lord. I get a report. There's not hardly a day that passes that I don't get a report about somebody putting me down. I'll have people call me on the telephone to come by my house. Did you hear about Sister So-and-so? Said, boy, she's putting you down again. Amen. Did you hear about old brother loud mouths and his mouth got loud again? Amen. Praise God. I said, well, glory to Jesus. Thank you, Lord, but I'm not going to let them stop me. I'm not going to let them hinder me. I got something that's too good. I got something that's too real to let anybody's gossip, let people's fault find and get me down. Praise God. I said, praise God. I'm going on. How many of you saints are going on? You going on? Yes, right. We're going on. Oh, yes, we are. Talking about healing for our soul. Jesus forgives and heals. How many believes he does? Psalms 143:3. He healeth the broken in heart and bindeth up their wounds. And I receive that. Amen. How many receives that? He healeth the broken in heart. Amen. That's not a disease of the body that a natural medicine could cure. He's talking about something other that's stronger than that. He's talking about something other that's more powerful than that. He's talking about the people that's broken in the heart. Amen. It bindeth up their wounds. He's talking about wounds that's been inflicted by some kind of thing of the object of wounding of the flesh, like a knife or spear or a bullet or something like that. He's talking about man's heart. He's talking about that inward part of man, the center of man's thoughts and actions, that heart. How many knows this? Praise God. He's talking about that broken heart. That your heart cries, your heart gets hurt. How many's ever had your heart hurt? Has anybody ever hurt you in your heart? People's disappointed you, people's let you down. Your heart would bleed for them. It's a saying, somebody said, my heart just bleeds for them. My heart just goes out. They have wounded my heart. They have wounded me on the inside. And only God can heal this wound up that I've been wounded with. Hallelujah. But God said he'd do it. How many knows he said? Amen. He'd bind up the broken in heart. Amen. He'd bring forth healing for the wounds. And you say, thank you, Jesus. Praise God. There's been people that's wounded me in my heart so bad. If it hadn't been for God, I guess I just forgot it all. I just threw up my hands and said, God, what's the use? But somewhere between going on and giving up, I found Jesus. I found the comfort somewhere between quitting, amen, and getting a new zeal, a new determination, somewhere about halfway in between of forgetting it all and going on, I found Christ. And now by Hosea, I felt his touch again. Amen. He began to bind up my broken heart. And he began to bring forth, amen, and let his blood be spread across my wounds. Amen. By his stripes, amen, I was healed of my wound in my heart. Amen. I picked up the pieces and I went on. I know sometimes you got to pick up the pieces and go on. Is that right? There's not a soul in this building tonight that hasn't been hurt by another person one time or another. I mean hurt deep. How many of you in here have been hurt deep by another person? I mean it cuts you all the way down to the very center of your heart. Hallelujah. Praise God. But the Lord heals that wound. Oh yes, he does. You know what he'll do? He'll take that forgiveness that you accepted, that you received from him, and he'll put it in your heart, and the forgiveness will flow out of you then. The forgiveness that was offered you from the Lord Jesus Christ, you accepted in your heart and your life, and then you have a forgiving heart that your heart reaches out to forgive other people. How many believes it does? You become Christ-like. Thank you, Jesus. Boy, what a message. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to Jesus. And there's the power. We're talking about forgiveness, healing, and power. And I want to get the power in. Power to become sons of God. How many knows he said? St. John chapter 1, verse 12. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to the Lamb. And I've seen something today special about this power. I'm after this power myself. I know that power is the next thing around for most of us. Power to become sons of God. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. How many knows who he was talking to? God has given the believer power to have power. How many believes he has? He told me today, he said, I've given you power to have power. And he told me how you can have more power than what you got. We've got the power within us to get power. Hallelujah. Thank God for that. I done got on the right track of finding out how to get more power. Glory to Hansaroko Yaha. Hallelujah. Power to get more power. And he told me how you can do it. How many wants to know? How many cares? How many is concerned? How many wants more power with God? A greater victory with God. Thank you, Jesus. Things that used to hurt you is not going to hurt you. That's right. You just don't know how great that is until you get it within you. When you can get that thing within you, hey, amen, they use things that people say and do about you, it would hurt you down to the very depths of your heart and your soul if possible. Now then, you got the victory. Now then, amen. You'll be willing to lay down your life, amen, for somebody else. You'll be able to pray a prayer like Jesus prayed when he was hanging on the cross and the blood was a gushing out of his side and a dripping out of his hands and his feet. And he looked down that bloodthirsty mob and he said, Father, he said, forgive them. He said, well, they know not what they do. I mean, it was just right. He put something on the inside of you that you'll have that Stephen had when he was stoned to death in his dying, agonizing moments of pain. Amen. Inflicted in the flesh. Amen. He said, Father, he said, not this sin of their charge. I want you to know this is what Christ will do for you. He'll put something everlasting on the inside of you. How many knows he will? Praise God. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. You'll be able to pray for him. Yes, you will. He said, if you want more power, it's our dedication to God. In prayer, fastings, reading and studying of his word. It's our loyalty in giving and serving, praising and worshiping. It gives us more power to get more power. As it gives us more power to get. You know what we do when we stay, brother, for these few minutes after this service? You know what that does for us? That gives us more power to get more power for the next service. How many knows it does? It gives you more power when you stay. If you don't stay but 15 minutes, it gives you more power to get more power to face tomorrow. Hallelujah. Oh yes, it does. Every time that you go to God sincerely in prayer, you mean business, it gives you more power to be able to pray easier the next time. You finally get where you'll be able to touch God in no time. Sometimes it take you a half a day to even feel a come a tie my tie or shake my shoe. Amen. Or loosen my tie, loosen my shoe. How many know what I'm talking about? Amen. Sometimes you'll pray for 2 or 3 hours and you won't get not one goosebump. Amen. But God will bring you into place if you'll dedicate yourself, if you'll read God's word, if you'll study God's word, if you'll fast every once in a while, if you'll praise God when you go to church, if you'll worship God, if you'll be loyal to God in your giving, amen, and your praise and your worship, if you'll be loyal to God, I want you to know you'll say, Lord, in Jesus' name, at that time, the power of the Holy Ghost, the power of the Holy Ghost will hit you on top of the head, amen, that God, you'll start rejoicing, and you say, thank God. God. Amen. Take them old brass heavens and bust them up. Make jello out of them. Where you was facing brass, something as hard as brass. When the heavens become as brass too, and you can't get through to God. How many knows what I'm saying? How many of you was there, went somewhere and tried to pray and seemed like you couldn't touch God for nothing? Feel like God done forgot about you and left and took up with somebody and helping somebody else and got all about you. You pray and you bawl and you squall. Amen to God. You seem like you can't get in touch with God and the devil tries to convince you to just forget about it and come back and try again some other time. But God will give you something other than just as soon as your knees hits the floor, the power of God hits the top of your head. Hallelujah. I mean, what's this kind of power? God said, I'll give my people power to get power. He said, they'll do what I said. They'll dedicate themselves, amen, to God, that they'll abide by my sayings and my teachings and my instructions. He said, I'll give them power to get more power. And he said, thank God. Amen. You'll be able to walk forth and not fear what man can do to you. Fear not man that's able to destroy the body, but rather fear God that's able to destroy both soul and body and to cast it into hell or everlasting torment. Hallelujah. I say you'll walk in the midst of the lions. Amen. You won't be afraid. I said you won't be afraid. Glory to God. Hey man, you'll pull your shoelaces out of your shoes and use them for a whip against big lions. Hey, come on, lions, I got my shoestrings in my hand. Somebody say praise God. I said somebody say glory. You can walk through the valley of the shadow of death when you're gasping for breath, knowing that God's going to be with you, knowing that God's going to come to your rescue, knowing that when you lay hands on one of your loved ones that's about ready to slip off into eternity, that you can put your hand on their head and rebuke that power away from them, and the devil will have to go. And you say, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, you can. You can rebuke sickness away from your door and the doors of your neighbors. Power to get power. Amen. How many knows he said he'd do it? But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Well, if you are my Lord God, what did Jesus do? He gave me and you the power that we could be like him. He gave us the power to become as the sons of God. Amen. He gave you the power to become like he is. Then you go out there and tell somebody else about his power, and the power come on them. And the power just keep on manifesting itself from one to another. And that's what's going to break this revival out. How many believes this is true? Amen. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, in conclusion. Talk about forgiveness, healing, and power. It's the three things that comes from accepting Christ. It's three things that goes with salvation. I'm proud of it. It's brought me over here since 1964, I can tell you. Oh, yes, it has. I've got this far since November the 8th of 64. Ephesians 6 and 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. The power of his might lives inside of me and you. He gave it to us. And then right, brother in the back, then it said, you shall receive power. After the Holy Ghost has come upon you, he said, you shall receive power. The power of his might lives and dwells and walks and talks. Amen. Inside of those that received him. To as many as received him. To them gave you the power to become the sons of God. And now then that Christ lives on the inside of me and you. And nothing shall be impossible to him that believeth. But to him that believeth, all things shall be possible. How many believe this is the word of God? Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh my God, I feel the Holy Ghost sigh on you. Slip up your hand and say, Lord, give me power to get power. I said, God, give me power to get power. Amen. It's all for mine, your receiving. It's all for mine, your, amen, accepting. That's right. Praise God. God will give you power to believe against the things that's plagued you. But you can believe that God will give you the victory over these things. And then you'll come across somebody else who's plagued with the same thing that you once was plagued with. And you get them delivered. Hallelujah. I said glory. God will make you strong. He said be strong. How many knows it is? Be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. God wants you to be strong. God wants you to be as strong and tall as big oak trees. Amen. I ain't letting every little wind, wind of Dr. Slater men blow me around. I'm founded upon something that's genuine. I'm founded upon something that's going to stand. And if the wind and the wiles of Satan come out against me in this church, God's giving you something out of here that can stand the forces of hell. How many believe that's right? The devil's done it. He can try to blow us out of Pearl River County, but we're still here. He might not be but a handful of us, but we're still here. You know why? Because we've been founded upon the Word of God. And this Word's going to stand when everything else falls to the ground and comes to naught. How many believe the Word's going to stand? Amen. Oh, yes, it will. And God's going to reward us one of these days for this. You wait and see. You know he's, the blessing of God's going to have to overtake us sooner or later here. Don't you believe that? God's going to let us be overtook by his blessings after a while. Folks are going to be wanting to get in here. And be wanting to be part of us then. Hallelujah. There's those that get sin. I believe that this camp meeting is a door open for people to get in. I believe that the door swung wide open. God's establishing, reestablishing this church right now. And God's going to put something other real here. Amen to God. And those that has the courage and the boldness that's left over from the old bunch. Amen to the old crowd. If you got the boldness and the courage to stand, God's going to bring you some new ones. And we're going to go on. We're going to come forward with a new strength in the Lord. Oh, my, I say praise God. I'm in appreciation of Jesus of Nazareth. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. God sees us standing here. How many of these God sees us standing here? God sees us right here on this Monday night. God knows all about it. God be for you, who can be against you? God's on your side. Amen. How many of the Lord's on your side? Amen. Let's all stand. Praise.